Do you have an encounter you'd like to hear narrated on this channel? Well, if so, what are you waiting for? Get on in there and send me an email with all the details. You can send your email to contact@BuckeyeBigfoot.com. Well, hey there, Sasquatch. I'm glad to see you. Thanks for joining me for tonight's journey down into Sasquatch Valley. Now, tonight our journey will take us to Northern California, home of Bigfoots everywhere, I think. This is where a man says he was followed, or in his own words, hunted for days by a Sasquatch while he was out on the Pacific Crest Trail. This is a good one, I think. So grab your snackage. Let's get going. We got a lot of ground to cover tonight. Let's go. Hello, Nance, to you and all of your listeners. I have an encounter that spanned several days, and once I understood what was actually happening, it chilled me to the bone, and it still does to this day. I had planned to hike for most of my summer college break that year. I've spent most of my life hiking and camping in many different areas of North America. The Pacific Crest Trail was, and is still, my biggest challenge. And while many strange things have happened or have been heard while I've been out hiking all over North America, there has never been anything that felt so ominous and dangerous as the one I'm about to tell you about. I had picked up the Pacific Crest Trail at the Etna Summit Trailhead. It was late June, and the temperatures were warm, but not hot. The weather was clear, there had been no rain, no mist or fog, and none was forecasted. I had perfect, ideal conditions for the week ahead. On the second day out, though, I started to feel apprehensive about, well, something. But what that something was, I just couldn't decide. The weather was fine, and nothing was going on. And despite what people say, mountain lions and bears really aren't all that common on the Pacific Crest Trail. So I didn't think that's what it was. But I felt uneasy. I'm more likely to run into sketchy humans than bears or mountain lions as a rule. And in the section I was in, which is still in California, I knew there shouldn't have been any bears. But something made my skin prickle, very much like the few times I have ran into a large predator, or should I say, just before I ran into the large predator. So I was on high alert all day, and by evening I was telling myself to stop it. Nothing was happening. Now, I wasn't some animal expert, but I did not think that a bear or a mountain lion or any other animal would spend an entire day stalking their prey for hours and hours and not making a move at all, even when there had been ample opportunities. I had moved slowly through the day, taking extra time to look around me. I was so sure I was being followed. So much so that at one point I backtracked a half mile or more to see if I saw any signs or prints that I was being followed or stalked by animal or human. No matter how hard I looked, I didn't see anything. But I didn't cover the ground on that day that I normally do for a hike. That night, I was camped in the Marble Valley, which is about a half mile from Canyon Creek. Even so, I was not ruling out that I just might be being stalked by some animal, and maybe that is what was making me feel so jumpy. No matter what I did, or how I tried to reassure myself, I could not shake that feeling. And this was unusual for me being out on the trail, which is where I felt very comfortable, well, most of the time. I set up my camp that night in a very large, natural opening between several thick bands of trees. I was too unsettled to sleep in the trees. I wanted to have a clear opening all around me. I don't know, I felt that I would be more likely to hear or know if something came into my camp that way. After a quick meal from one of those foil pouches, I settled into my tent for the night. I was almost gone all the way to Sleepland when a howling like I've never heard ripped through the otherwise silent night. I sat up in my tent, got my headlamp on, and grabbed the bear spray and my handgun. I didn't want to use either of them, but I also didn't want to wait in my tent like some wrapped-up midnight snack for some angry animal. When I heard that howl, I couldn't place what it was. It didn't sound like bear, and it didn't sound like a mountain lion. It didn't sound like anything that I knew could possibly be in that area. At the time, as far as I was aware, there were no more brown bears in California. But I also had learned, even by then, never, ever discount Mother Nature. She's never completely out of the game, and she will throw you a curveball whenever she good and well feels like it, including throwing a brown bear where there shouldn't be any. So the thing is, all those kinds of facts and thoughts were going through my mind like lightning that night, all while I'm listening to these insane howls out there. And I was really wanting to think what I heard was a bear or some hurt mountain lion, because those would have been normal, and I would know what to do with those. But what I was hearing couldn't have been either of those, and I didn't like that thought. I was listening to those howls going off every few minutes as I stood in front of my tent in the darkness, and you know what I figured out? Whatever was doing that howling, whatever it was moving, almost in a circle around where I was, but it was some distance out, maybe 40 or 50 yards out away from me. When you stand in complete darkness, and you stand there listening to hear every sound, you will hear a lot of sounds out in the woods at night. And I was hearing movement between howls. It also stayed well into the trees. It never seemed to come out into the opening where I was. I was suddenly very glad I had listened to my gut when I set up where to sleep that night. The hair was standing up on the back of my neck when I knew this whatever it was circling my area. At one point, I thought I heard something that could be out in the open close to my tent. In a panic, I switched my headlamp on, and I swept the area all around my tent. The light from my headlamp was cast out a good distance away, and although I didn't see anything, I did not let my guard down. Something just still felt very off. The other thing was that the very second that my headlamp light came on, everything out there stopped. I mean everything. There were no more movement sounds, no more howling, and the only thing I heard was my own heartbeat and my own breathing. I did that sweep all around my tent, and then I clicked my headlamp off as fast as I could. I felt like that headlamp was some large bullseye out there in the darkness, just in case anyone or anything was out there in the trees. It was like I was a lighthouse, a beacon in the darkness. I did not want to draw anything near. So I stood there in the darkness, just listening for any sound. I waited in the dark like that for several minutes. Then I heard the sound of movement again. But now it was moving away from my location. But I was still sweating and straining to see anything in the darkness out there. In all the years that I've been hiking, I never had anything like this happen. And for the record, I typically do not hike alone. I was supposed to have someone with me on this hike, but due to their family reasons, they had to back out at the last second. But I felt confident enough to do this hike alone. I've done longer and more arduous hikes alone, so I felt confident. But now I was second-guessing myself. It was a long night, and I sat there waiting until the sun came up. I sat there outside of my tent in the darkness and waited until the sky got light. I had made no fire the night before. I typically try not to use much of a fire, if any at all. I wasn't going out to get the material for fire making in the darkness, so I had sat there as quietly as I could. Again, I, for some reason, felt like I did not want to be trapped in my tent, and that was a feeling I wasn't used to having. I usually viewed my tent as some kind of a sanctuary. But come morning, I really screwed up. Since I hadn't slept that night, I thought I'd grab a few hours of sleep when the sun came up. Then I would move on down the trail. I'd done this before when I hadn't been able to sleep for some reason. It's like I felt safer sleeping out in the sunlight. And maybe I was. And maybe I wasn't. But that's how I felt. So I set the alarm on my watch and fell asleep on the morning of the third day. And when I woke up, it was very late in the afternoon. I don't know what happened. I don't know if I turned my alarm off while I was half asleep or if I managed to never set the alarm correctly to begin with. But I woke up, and the shadows were deep and long. It was after 4 p.m. I had slept for over 9 hours. I had that moment of panic that I normally only ever have when I've overslept, and I suddenly realize I'm not going to make it to class or to work on time. I packed everything up as fast as I could, and I started walking as fast as I could. I wanted to put as much distance between that area and whatever it was as I could before nightfall. I didn't want to be in that area when night came. I knew I'd be lucky to make 2 or 3 miles before it was dusk and time to set up my tent again. I like to scout my area and set up well before dusk, but this day I pushed it to setting up at dusk. Now the whole way I'm talking bad things to myself because I realized that since I had slept the whole day, I was probably not going to sleep much that night, and that tomorrow I was going to be exhausted, but I had to do that to get back on the right schedule. But little did I know that I probably wouldn't have slept that night anyway, even if I had been up all day. Now, the only food that I carried was freeze-dried and sealed in foil pouches straight from the manufacturer. I had never had an animal bother them. There's nothing to smell. But I still put everything I had in a bag up in a tree away from my tent that evening. I did that every night. Now that night, I tried to sleep, but was tossing and turning, and my eyes popped right open when I heard a tree limb begin to slowly creak, then snap, and then break. It was a slow sound, like something being pulled on, and the weight kept increasing the pressure on it until it gave way. This was not a fast snap and break. It was a long creak before it gave way. Again, I was feeling trapped inside my tent. If there was something out there, I wanted to be able to face it standing up. So again, I spent half the night outside my tent, bear spray in one hand and my handgun holstered on my thigh. I had my headlamp on, but I left it mostly turned off. And just like the night before, I heard something circling far outside of my position. I thought, this is crazy. Nothing's going to follow me for miles and miles, especially not for more than one day. I didn't know what was going on, but I was getting pretty darn tired of it. Now, after a while, things went quiet, and I did doze on and off once I made it back inside my tent, but I think the dozing was more off than on. When I woke up, it was light outside, and I was startled to see that it was so bright. I guess that last bit of sleep I got was longer than all the rest put together. And even though it looked early morning, I checked my watch to make sure I hadn't slept through the day again. And thankfully I hadn't. It was just after 7 a.m. Good, I thought. I have a chance to get back on a normal schedule. I was pretty hungry, and I was still feeling a little bit sleep-deprived, but I walked over to get my pouch of food off the tree, only to find that my whole food bag had been taken. More to the point, the tree branch that I had hung my food pack on had been broken off. I guess that was what I had heard in the night. And let me tell you, this tree branch was probably about 4 inches in diameter, and it was healthy. It was not old, it was not rotted, and it was not small. Well, I sure was not happy, as that was all the food I had left for the remainder of my hike. I had at least 2 more days to get to the pickup point that I had arranged with a friend, but I had 3.5 days more of food in there, just to be sure. Well, I thought I had gone longer without food on a hike before, and I was in no danger of starving. I was about 20 or 25 miles, give or take, from Seidel Valley. It was summertime, and I was in otherwise tip-top good health. 2 or even 3 days without food did not put me in danger. So I packed up my tent and started heading on down the trail. I want to take a second and explain my hiking goals for that week. I had planned to hike a section of the trail from Etna up to Seidel Valley. It's just under 60 miles, which I have hiked farther than that many times before and in far less time. But I planned for this to be a leisurely hike. I wasn't hiking just to tick something off a box or to cover a lot of ground or to say that I made it from here to here in record time. No, not at all. I had actually hiked this section previously, going both northbound and southbound. Previous hikes through the area were focused more on making it in certain times because I was often hiking with other people. But I planned this hike to be leisurely, to look, to explore, to enjoy, to take as much zero time as I wanted. So I was planning roughly 10 to 15 miles a day, which, for the elevations and the climb, was a fair amount of hiking. But I was in excellent shape, you see. But it would suck hiking on an empty stomach, but I knew I would survive. Actually, the thing I missed the most out of that food pack was my freeze-dried coffee. So anyway, on this day, I started down the trail on an empty stomach and no coffee. But within the first half hour, I knew I was being followed. This was no longer a feeling. It was a certainty. From behind me, I would hear bracken on the forest ground being stepped on. I would hear little snaps and breaks. Thankful that I had kept my life straw and water bottle in my pack and not with my food, I stopped abruptly to get my bottle out of my pack, and I clearly heard footsteps and those little snaps and breaks behind me some ways back. I turned as fast as I could, but there was nothing and no one there to be seen. Even still, the hair was rising up on the back of my arms. And that isn't a joke or just something to say. I looked down, and I literally saw the hair on my arms raising up from the skin. Now, until this point in all these days, despite how I had felt, I had seen nothing. I had heard howls. I had heard my camp being circled at night. I had heard a tree limb break, which just happened to be the one that my food bag was tied up in. But I had not seen anything. I also want to add that other than the feelings that I had had, most of the weird things had happened at night, not during the day. But at that moment, it was a bright sunny morning, and I knew with a certainty in my gut that I was absolutely being followed. I felt like I was being hunted, and I felt that this was an intelligent thing, probably a person, not an animal. This was calculated. Bears, they don't do that. Neither do mountain lions. They'll stalk you, but they don't wait too long. They want their meal. But this was different. You know, there are some really strange people you can meet out on those trails. 99% of them are great. They're wonderful. They're nice. There's always that 1%, and those are the ones you have to look out for. And there are some of them out there who are truly homeless, and they are mentally unbalanced. Mostly, they just steal food or other supplies from you. But you cannot ever rule out that one of them could be very dangerous. And that's where my mind went that morning. I had had things stolen from me, and I was being followed or hunted. I felt that I had been being followed truthfully for days, and I was certain it was the same person. I did not believe for 1 second that an animal would follow me for that long, as I have already explained. I took a second to assess my situation. I was 2 days or less out from my pickup in Sidle Valley. I had seen almost no one coming or going on the trail, which I found odd for June. I had no cell phone reception. I had no food and only some water. I had two forms of protection with me, my bear spray and a handgun. I was in reasonably good shape, and I had taken some self-defense courses over the years. So I steadied my breathing and decided the best defense I had was a clear, unpanicked mind and my confidence. With those thoughts, I gave a meaningful glance to the trail behind me, and I decided to call out, "I know you're there. Just be warned, whoever you are, I am armed, and I am aware of you." I waited for perhaps 30 or 45 seconds to see if they would show themselves or give some kind of reply, but there was nothing but silence. With that, I turned and did a half jog down the trail. I kept jogging. I knew that I could sustain that jog for probably 2 miles or more. As I had ran track for many years in high school, and since then, I often jogged for several miles on a programmed treadmill at home. It changed the elevation and pitch to mimic running up and down different elevations and mountain trails. So I was pretty sure whoever was behind me, well, they probably couldn't do that for many miles. I mean, most people can't unless they've trained for it. I generally clock 5 to 6 miles an hour on those jogs on the treadmill. Out in the real world, with uneven ground and having to look where I was going, I was leisurely jogging around 4 miles an hour. According to my wrist tracker, I set it to an alarm at 5 miles, so it would let me know when I had covered 5 miles. So I jogged my 5 miles in just over an hour. Then I stopped for a while, took a breath, and drank a little bit of water. Then I stepped way off the trail to relieve myself. That's just something you do as a courtesy. I mean, nobody wants to see human waste near the trail, and you don't want to be doing business when somebody comes up the trail and, you know, has a gander at you. It's just good manners, right? Well, I probably go 100 feet way off the trail. I'm squatting and doing some business quietly. I'd been squatted for perhaps, I don't know, 30, 45 seconds, and I hear someone coming down the trail. Unmistakably, I hear footsteps like someone is jogging. I could see from my position to the trail on the slight slope below me. As whoever it was got closer to where I had left the trail, they slowed down. It was as if they knew where I left the trail. I was waiting for them to get to where I could see them. I wasn't sure who it was that had been following me, but I was also thinking about how if this was just some casual hiker, how had I not seen them? We were only a minute, minute and a half apart from each other. I was covering the ground at a jogging pace, and I had not seen them before or behind me. For them to hike past me, they would have passed me that morning if I was to pass them while jogging today. And I would certainly have overtaken them while jogging, right? I mean, they were only a minute and a half, maybe 2 minutes behind me. We couldn't be that close together and sustain the exact amount of speed all day. Could we? I mean, without seeing each other? These were my thoughts, and they were going through my head. Then I realized everything had gone quiet. I mean everything. Down to the forest floor sounds, there was nothing. Not a bird, not a chirp, nothing. Now that scared me. In all my years of hiking, I had only heard that one other time, and that was when a mountain lion was about to pounce. I finished my business faster than ever, pulled my pants up, and then quietly made my way back to the trail as close as I dared to get to it. The whole time it was feeling like some horrible horror movie. And the idle thought crossed my mind that if this was a movie, and if there was an audience watching this, what would they be yelling at me to do or not to do? I didn't know. But I had no real choice but to go back to the trail, and I was pretty sure the audience would be yelling me not to go to the trail. But there was no choice. This was not an area you wanted to trailblaze, believe me. I was already with no food. I did not want a chance going off trail, getting lost, and dying in the wilderness. Now that sounds pretty extreme, but ask anyone who hikes about that sort of thing. It's been known to happen. And if nothing else, all you have to do is look at the list of missing hikers and how they were found. And most of the time it's because they went off trail and starved. I did not want to go like that. So I very slowly made my way back to the trail. I'm still 20 feet from the trail, and I can see between trees a good distance up and down that piece of trail until it drops down on the ridge side. I stand there and I listen. I know I had heard someone, but try as I might, I saw no one. The thought that maybe someone else is just as good of a distance jogger as I am briefly did come through my mind. It was possible, of course, but the odds just weren't in the favor that some random person out there on the trail had trained to be that kind of a jogger as I had. So I take a couple steps towards the trail, and as I did so, I saw something out of the corner of my left eye. It had been there the whole time, I guess, but I hadn't noticed it. I saw the movement as it moved to stand behind a tree. I froze. I was confused. This thing was large, tall, and was very dark. What the bleep was it? Or who was it? Now, a strange thing happened to me when I saw this. All fear left me. I don't know where that fear went, but in its place came pure, red-hot anger. I was hungry, I was tired, and I was mentally exhausted. I felt like I was being hunted for somebody's sport, and I was being deliberately ran down to an exhausted state. I was furious. I yelled out to whoever it was, "What do you want from me, huh? What the bleep do you want?" To my surprise, what I saw stepped out so I could see it fully. Now I am saying it because this was no person. Somewhere before that, I think I knew it probably wasn't a person. I just hadn't got my whole mind on board with that yet. But it was now. It was taller and larger than any man I've ever seen in real life. And I watched in horror as it started to come towards me. I bent down and I picked up a stick and I threw it. I didn't hit it, of course. It landed way short, but the thing looked where the stick landed. Then it looked right back up at me in my face. It wasn't close enough that I could tell you what its face looked like in detail, but I feel like I remember its eyes for some reason. I was also aware that I was looking at a legendary creature. I didn't care, though. I was mad as all get out. It stopped when I had thrown that stick, but it was still looking at me, and it was a hard look. I pulled my gun, and without thinking, I started walking right for it. I can't explain what I was thinking. I was just seeing red. In retrospect, maybe this is how hikers go missing. I don't know. All I knew was I was fed up, and I was going to confront this thing. I had a gun after all, right? Well, this thing saw me coming. It watched me take a couple steps towards it. Then it decided to move. It didn't make a sound, but it just wheeled away and started walking through the trees at a pace that was equal to my slow jog. Then it went up and over the ridge top and down at an angle that I could not have possibly followed. I scrambled up to the ridge top and I looked down at it. I caught it in full sunlight, right where there were no trees, maybe 50 yards from where I stood. Its furry back was shiny in the sun. I saw it for maybe 4 or 5 seconds. Then it was gone in the shade of the trees further down the slope. That slope was so steep, I would have broken my neck walking straight down. The only way I could have followed would have been to go down sideways, and I would have been sliding most of the way. It was not worth the possibility of breaking my neck. I was angry, though, and right before it went down into the trees, I started yelling at it. I was so mad. It did turn briefly, and it looked at me when I was yelling at it. I remember being mad and yelling at it to get its big butt back up there. I don't know what I was thinking. I don't know that I could have killed it with just my gun. Maybe if I was at a very close range and took dead headshots on it. But the truth is, I really didn't want to be that close to it again. But I was still mad. How dare it walk away from me after chasing me for days? Now, just looking at it, even at a distance and with a gun in my hand, it was a terrifying thing to look at. And when I had looked it in the eye, when we were up there before it left, I sensed a strange animosity from it. Maybe that's what made me so mad. Now, what I sensed was not anger or hate exactly. It was some kind of disdain. It was like I was some roach it found in its kitchen, and it wasn't going to hesitate to exterminate me, and at the same time it was repulsed by me. I didn't know what else to think, but I think me confronting it made it change its plans. Now that sounds extreme, I know, but it was an extreme moment. If you've ever stood eye to eye with a dangerous animal in a zoo, you know how it is that you can pick up on what they're thinking and how they view you. Some animals will look at you with disinterest. Some will have curiosity. You can see it in their eyes and their faces. While others make it clear how they would very much like to get a hold of you. And this animal, this thing, made it very clear it did not like me. Which makes all the behavior of taking so much time to follow me for days made it so confusing. I didn't know what its goal was, and I don't know that I really wanted to know. At that moment, my heart was beating at an alarming pace. I had another quick, calming talk with myself, and then I got back on the trail and jogged another 2 miles straight. Then I slowed down and repeated my actions earlier of going off the trail to listen and observe to see if it was following again. I was sure. It had followed me again. I just knew it. But I went off trail and waited for over 10 minutes and heard and saw nothing. I backtracked another quarter mile, looking and listening. Again, nothing. By now I had covered half my day's hiking goal, and it was barely noon. So I pushed on, and I made it all the way to Seidel Valley, as dusk fell that night. I got a room there, and I called my friend to come get me first thing in the morning. Boy, was he surprised. Truthfully, so was I. I covered more ground than I thought possible, but I think fear spurred me on. The terror of realizing that that was probably what had been following me since the second day grew stronger overnight. I felt for sure it had been hunting me, but more like it wanted to play with me by doing so. I don't know what it wanted. Perhaps it didn't want anything at all. Maybe living in the forest is pretty boring, and me walking through was some kind of entertainment. Maybe it was intending to exhaust me, to wear me down. Maybe most humans give up from exhaustion much sooner than I would have, and they will put up no fight then, and they let their defenses go down much sooner. It's hard for me to say, but I do know that I was followed for miles on that trail by a Sasquatch. That explains the howls I heard. I now think it was telling me to get out, to leave. And if I had known that, I probably would have backtracked right out to Etna, which was much closer than the other end of my journey. but I didn't know what was happening in time. I do think things could have gone differently at many different moments during those days when I think back on them. I don't know why it fixated on me. I don't know for certain if it was really the same one the whole way, but I do feel like it was. All I know is I was hunted for days by a Sasquatch. For what purpose, I do not know. But I'm pretty sure it wouldn't have ended well for me. I have gone over so many of the moments of those days again and again. I think I triggered something when I started jogging, though. I wasn't doing an all-out run, not to trigger some kind of prey instinct drive in it. But I do think that if it had wanted to, it could have caught me at any time. I didn't know that then, though. Instead, it chose to keep pace with me for many miles. I don't understand why. Animals don't casually do that, do they? I think about all of this, and I feel very chilled inside. And for the record, no matter what, I never go hiking alone anymore. If someone ever backs out, so do I. I don't go alone, ever. And I suggest that you don't, either. I feel those Sasquatches like to pick on lone people. Signed, Troy Pearson. Well, thank you, Troy, for that scary and riveting encounter. I know I couldn't jog for miles. Too old for this old lady now. And don't worry, when I do out and hike, I don't ever go alone. I think that's good advice for everyone in general. All right, everyone, I do hope that you have a great weekend wherever you are. And as for us, well, again, we have a very full weekend ahead. Tomorrow morning, we're stopping by the Buckeye Bigfoot Trading Post. And no, this is not my trading post. It has nothing to do with me or this channel, but it's an actual trading post. Now, if you look up there on the screen, there's the information from their Facebook page. Now, it seems they've got all sorts of things going on. There are things that are Bigfoot related and things that aren't. It's going to be like a big flea market and craft fair, and there's all kinds of Bigfooty fun. So it looked like fun. So if you go, if you're there, if you see us, please say hello. All right, and of course, it's Cincinnati. So there's another Oktoberfest this weekend. There's one every weekend somewhere, a lot of weekends, multiple Oktoberfests going on. This weekend is Liberty Home in Hamilton, Ohio. It's halfway between Hamilton and Ross, Ohio. And we will be there. Again, if you see us, say hello. I don't know if I'm wearing my dirndl or not this weekend. It's going to be pretty hot, so maybe not. We'll see. Anyway, say hello. I do love talking to people and meeting people. All right, everyone. Well, that's it for this evening. I hope you have as much fun as I think I'll be having this weekend. But until we meet up again, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening.